Do you like that? Yeah, they're going cheap if you want them. You know what amazes me when I see you lot together? Not that you've stayed at the top for over 30 years, not that you've managed to keep coming back with different kind of sounds, but that you've stayed together for 35 years and your family.
Well, we all have families.
Yeah. But you know, I mean, I can't spend 10 minutes with my mother.
We don't know your mother, so...
Neither could you. But 35 years together.
Yeah. Well, we were little kids at the time, so we've grown up together, remember? So, like, 4 or 5 when we began.
Oh, I know, but...
I think we all have the same sense of humour, so I think it's a lot to do with that, and that we all had the same goal as we were children. We always wanted to be one day famous. So it's that goal that's still going on. That the three of us sort of made a pact when we were younger. And it's because we have the same sense of humour, we always have a lot of fun. So
it must be the sense of humour because, yeah. I mean, there's no other family band. Possibly The Bachelors is, you know, two of them are
Bachelors.
Brothers. But, I mean, there's no... there's no The Jacksons, you know, there's nobody. The Osmonds, they're not together.
No.
So who was...
Just as well, really, yes.
Who was the one, when you were little, who was the one who said... Come on, lads, let's sing. Or did it just spontaneously
It was totally organic. Is that the word?
Yeah, that's the word. Stick with that one.
Okay, I think I should. Yeah, totally organic. Spontaneous and completely out of the blue. We just started singing one day. Barry picked up a guitar.
So how old are we talking
about? 4 or 5 years old. Our average age was about 4 or 5, 6 that we started. That when you say we've been together that long, because we're little kids. I mean, remember, it's not a question of us being together. We're brothers, so obviously it was just something that we've always done.
And it was your dad who sort of put you on the sort of show-busy trail, wasn't it? Mm.
Well, it was the influence of our father being a drummer. He used to have a big band and he used to play the Mecca Circuit during World War II.
He accompanied the war.
Yeah.
He did the soundtrack to World War II.
And Mum was a band vocalist, so I think it had to be in our blood. So it was an instinctive thing.
I read somewhere that he never kind of gave you a pat on the back.
Well, no, it's not that he never gave us a pat on the back, because I'm sure he did in his own way. It was a long time. But he always complimented the audience. Mm. Yeah, when we came off stage and it had been a good show, he would always say, the audience was great tonight.
Yeah.
Well, that's great. Yeah. I mean, that was his way of complimenting us.
And you were very young. I think you were 12 and you were 9 when you then went to Australia.
A little earlier.
I was 12 when we arrived in Melbourne. Yeah, it was my 12th birthday, the day we arrived in Melbourne.
So we would have just turned 9 when we got there.
You were 9 when you left England. You were 12 when you arrived in Melbourne.
I arrived in Melbourne.
It was a long trip.
It's a long trip.
I don't want to cause a family row. The programme when the Beaches broke up. And was it there that you kind of sort of honed your act, wasn't it?
Yeah,
honed your act.
Well, in Australia, it's very difficult to, because we were kids, to sell records or be teenage type of audience. So we had to work to adults first in clubs and have an adult act and so forth, because that's really, we were supporting the family, so that's where the money was, and that's what we used to do.
Yeah, were you instruments then, or were you purely an a cappella?
Yeah, Barry always played guitar, and I picked up guitar about when I was 9. And I started getting into it, and then the two of us just played guitars, and Robin was sort of in the middle singing, and we just...
I've always been in the middle.
Yes.
Was it a big shock to you culturally, Australia, at that age?
Actually, no, it was paradise. I mean, when you were that age, and you're going to a beautiful, sunny country, because in those days they were immigrating, you know, they were trying to encourage the immigration. So it was £20, like £10 per parent, and kids travel free. Mm. So we were going to paradise, you know, because we were living in Manchester.
It was a journey as well. I mean, we saw the pyramids, and we were in India, and we're all these exotic countries at such an early age. So we've always had a feeling that that has something to do with our songwriting, you know? That we drew on all of that experience when we got older.
You drew on the pyramids, didn't you?
We even drew on the pyramids, yes.
A kind of a pattern's emerging about...
It is, isn't it?
Yeah,
it is.
Ask us something else.
Yeah. I mean, is there one of you who says, come on, guys, we do this?
Is
Which would
one?
That be, I wonder?
No, I don't know.
Now, would you mean is there one person who said, let's do this?
Yeah.
No.
There isn't. It's just organic.
That's that word again. It is organic.
Yeah.
Well, we're all brothers, but I'm the eldest brother.
I think at various times there's different leaders, like now.
Yeah, that's a good one.
So you have the last say, do you?
I have no comment to make on this.
Oh, he has nothing to say on this.
Do you go back to Australia much now? I mean, I remember, because you're from the Isle of Man, weren't you?
Yes, that's right. We're Manx.
Because people say it's Manchester, but
we were born in Douglas, in the Isle of Man, the three of us. Every time my mother got pregnant, she went for a holiday in the Isle of Man. And she got pregnant with us three, of course, but not all at the same time, of course.
But you two at the same time.
I was two at the same time, two egg twins.
So where were we on this one? Do you go back to Australia much now?
We went back last. The last time we did go back was 1989.
Yeah. Yes.
It was part of a tour. And we intend to go back on the next tour, which starts next April.
Yeah. Do you have family and friends over there?
We have our sister, Leslie, and her family, which is, I think, eight children, to be fair.
I think it was nine. Fair,
she's got a huge family. It looks like the cover of Sgt. Pepper.
Listen, we heard you at the top of the show then.
That's right.
With electric guitar.
Electric guitar.
And we're going to hear you again a little bit later.
I know what you're going to say here.
Could you just kind of hone in on me and let it organically sort of happen?
Or what you want is an organic feel to the music this time. It's sort of a little bit more sort of.
Oh, I've got my organic.
No, I don't want you to play.
All right, okay.
Yeah, no, I do.
All right, we're doing acapulco.
That's a good job we didn't bring on guitar, isn't it?
Yeah. Perhaps just sit there sort and organically of, feel it between you.
We just sit here and take our clothes off.
Do it. Oh, Lord, I knew he'd be trouble.
I'm not trouble. You say, oh, we've got the boys on the edge, you see.
You're on the edge. Yeah. All right, go on then. Be on.
Stay with us. Don't go yet.
Any day now.
Okay.
This is the one we wrote in.
Yeah, see if you remember this. I don't.
Nobody gets too much heaven no more. It's much harder to come back. I'm waiting in line. Nobody gets too much love anymore. It's as high as a mountain and harder to climb. Oh, you and me, girl, got a lot of love in store. And it flows through you, and it flows through me, and I love you so much more. Than my life, I can see beyond forever. Everything we are will never die. Love is such a beautiful thing. A summer day, are you just a dream to fade away? Nobody gets too much heaven no more. It's much harder to come back. I'm waiting in line. Nobody gets too much love anymore. It's as high as a mountain.
Yeah. I haven't finished yet.
Hang on. It's Joe, Joe, the preacher talked with me and he smiled. Said, come and walk with me, and we'll walk more miles. Now for once in your life, you're alone. But you ain't got a dime, there's no time for the phone.
Oh!
any idea how nauseating that is to someone like me?
Well, it wasn't
that bad. No, someone like me who can't sing and can't play, and you're just sitting there completely effortlessly.
Well, you're very kind. Thank you.
Kind words.
Loved them all, but the one that really like took me straight back then was Jive Talking, because I can suddenly see you in the 70s with a wonderful white suit you used to wear, didn't you? And those wonderful kind of flares.
Well, can we make a point here? Yeah. We never wore a white suit. We wore short white jackets and white pants, but they were never as flared as it seems to have turned out that everyone thinks we were.
They got bigger and bigger, I think.
I think the Jacksons in that period, flares were actually, were, I think, 3 yards wider, you know.
We never actually got into those things. We're very jeans and t-shirts kind of people.
People, really.
Well, let's just remind ourselves exactly what you did look like then. Let's look at the trousers that launched 1,000 sail ships. Those trousers that launched all the cracks about, no wonder they sing so high.
Actually, it was more of a John Travolta's image than ours. It was sort of with the white suit and the black shirt and all that. That was the front cover of the album, so that was, you know, it was such a phenomenon, it was such a success.
The film was actually very big. We never actually actively promoted the film, so it was a big film.
If you look at the cover of the album, though, the back of the album is a picture of us. You can't see our pants at all.
No, we weren't wearing any.
We were wearing boiler suits, actually.
How did you discover that, you know, higher registers, not
Well, it's a long story. we discovered it during a song called Nights on Broadway. Thank you.
Hello, mother.
How'd you get it? We were experimenting, I won't say that.
No, don't.
Our producer said, we need a high screaming voice. Yeah. To go out at the end of Nights on Broadway. Thing. Come one of you, try and do that. So I volunteered, and they pushed me into the studio.
Yeah.
And started screaming, and I found out that I could actually do that, and do it, like, melodically. I could actually sing a song that way. And I didn't know I could do that until that.
But having said that, there's only about 3 or 4 big records where we actually, featured. That kind of falsetto.
There's lots of songs with me doing.
No, I'm talking about the key singles from Nights on, from Saturday Fever album.
Yeah, but the whole, most of Spirits having flown following that.
Yeah, the singles, anyway, yeah.
Excuse us.
Yeah, sorry, I don't want to interrupt at all. The Saturday Night Fever, as you said, that album was the most, you know, the biggest selling album of all times at that time. 6 consecutive.
It's still the biggest film soundtrack of all time.
Biggest film soundtrack.
So let's at least give it credit.
Yeah. And, sorry.
And it's still the second biggest selling album of all time.
There was Thriller. Right.
No, but when you're talking about a phenomenon that size, no one can predict it. I mean, I spoke to Quincy Jones about Thriller that
he said, go away.
He said, get out of the way. No. And Quincy actually said, we expected to sell 2-3 million. They didn't expect it to sell as many as it did. And nobody did about Fever. It wasn't a high profile picture. Yeah. It wasn't a Jurassic Park. There was no great promotion.
Well, it didn't have a hype. It didn't have any big money in the promotion. Yeah,
but did you worry that it was so successful? Everyone wants success in their career. But when you get there, it's like, can we do it again? And can we better it? Was that a fear?
We never tried to think. It was a project to us that we gave 3 or 4 songs to. It wasn't sort of a big career move. We were coming off 3 or 4 platinum albums before that. We were in the studio making our new album. So we gave them a few songs and they got on with it. Just as anybody would for a film, and then the soundtrack came out. And we saw the movie, and the movie was a big success.
We prefer these times now because they're more smooth, and not so chaotic, and we can make our albums comfortably. And if people like our music, can respond to it. But when you have a situation like that, your life literally goes crazy.
Is that why in the 80s that you took a lot of time off?
Yes.
Yeah, well, when you say time off, we wrote and produced for other people.
Absolutely.
We
never really just stopped. Chain Reaction, Dinah Ross.
Yeah. We moved back from the forefront. We tried to stop being that entity on purpose.
We purposely stopped being the Bee Gees for a few years to let the Fever period cool down.
Yeah.
We needed to do that. We wrote Islands in the Stream and produced Kenny Rogers and Dolly Parton. Well, Barry produced and we wrote. Chain Reaction for Dinah Ross, Heartbreaker, Dionne Warwick, the Guilty album with Woman in Love. And then that's when we came to You Win Again in 88. And the return of their
I think we were trying to become better songwriters. We thought if we stop becoming that entity, we can concentrate on our songwriting, which, when all said and done, is really what we do. The singing part of it and the performing part of it all stems from this core of the three of us writing songs since being very, very young. That's what we do. That's our ability.
Without the song, you have nothing.
We are songwriters. We write and written all our own songs.
You're over here at the moment.
We certainly are.
promoting your album, which I'll talk about in a minute.
Yes, of course.
You're also here to do Children in Need tonight, yes. Which you've never done before, have you?
No.
But you have done an awful lot of other charity work. You're going to do a concert for Children of Bosnia?
Well, we're trying to put a concert together for the Children of Bosnia with other artists. The difficult thing is getting other artists to take a political standpoint. Our real motive is, or our real message is, is it possible to get the kids out? Is it possible to remove all children, no matter what side they're on? That's what our argument is. The children and the mothers, you know, men always seem to want to fight, so let them fight.
Well, I love a good fight.
He likes a good fight.
Yeah.
Is it not possible that we can stop for a month, remove all children, and then, you know, have your battles, you know? So that's what we're trying to do. That's just our message. So we've got a song on our new album called Blue Ireland, which is a message dedicated to those children.
Well, let's just go behind the scenes a minute for us, for Children in Need, and join Ross down in London so that you can see just what you're in for tonight.
No.
Yes, Judy, it's the world-famous BBC Television Centre here in London.
So there you are. That's what you're in for tonight. Now, I know you won't tell me exactly what, but you are going to be doing something from your latest album tonight, aren't you?
Yes.
Size isn't everything. Why have you called it that? Because, I mean, you're all quite tall.
Well...
yes, of course, sure. Of course.
Judy.
Yes.
Well, we call it size... First of all, it's not personal.
No.
And
better not be.
No, it's really the width that's more important. Yeah. But size and everything, it was more of a fun title. It also means, basically, don't judge a book by its cover. No matter how you're perceived as of what we are, or what we've been, or what we're doing, just listen to the music.
And it's fun. It's a bit of a joke, really.
Now, talking of humour, you get yourself into a bit of trouble with the press, don't you?
I'm always getting myself into trouble with the press.
What is all this caper?
But I haven't actually said anything to the press. It was, you're touching on the story about my wife earlier in the week.
Yeah.
That was basically a radio show in New York called Howard Stern, Shock Jock. And they don't have anything like it in England. It just went completely awry because he likes the shock. He talks about everybody, including his own family.
So the allusions you were making about sexual activities were a joke?
Absolutely, but it just totally backfired. And again, it wasn't a sort of serious statement about my life. It was more of a conversation that sort of rolled on early in the morning, and it happens to have gone to 17 cities, and it was the number one show in the country. So when people hear things like that, even in jest, it just gets picked up.
So you won't be doing that one again then?
Well, I wouldn't say I wouldn't do it.
You'll probably be doing it, but won't say that again.
who's going to be the one? You've been singing together for 35 years, as we've said. Who's going to be the one who turns around one day and says, "That's it, guys"? Or will you all know organically?
Probably Mum.
we're just going to keep on doing what we do because we love it. We enjoy doing what we're doing. There's no cut-off moment. We just feel, as long as we feel that we've got something good to contribute, and we enjoy what we're doing, we love writing and producing, then we'll keep on doing it. It's like painting. You just have to do what you do.
Because
we paint as well, of course, by the way.
Oh, do you?
Oh, yeah.
No. You don't at all, do you?
No, we don't.
Not what you'd like to see anyway.
Because, I mean, also, I mean, the high-pitched stuff, I mean, you're not going to be able to keep that up forever.
Yeah, but we don't do that all the time. That's not just...
Well, no, I know, but it's become such a feature that it's recognised now. Mm. Nobody else
does. Actually, it's stronger than ever.
Is it?
So, So I think it's down to exercise. I think if you don't exercise any given muscle, it's not going to work properly. And I exercise that particular muscle quite a lot. So.
I'm so glad you said that.
Thank you. So the falsetto part of my voice is as strong as it ever was. In fact, stronger than it was.
But you'll actually hear records where Barry doesn't do any falsetto at all.
Oh, I know. I mean, there's plenty of
them. Yeah, but I'm very proud of him.
He's very proud.
He loved to do it.
And, he's a very proud man.
And I think Brian Wilson should be proud of his. And
Beach
I think
Boys,
Frankie Valli should be very proud of his. Sure.
And Eric Smith of 12 Arcadia Gods. He didn't say he was very
proud. I particularly like his. Will you be... You'll be touring soon?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, we're planning a world tour in April where we'll go everywhere.
And, well, that's what you do in the world.
And also Latin America, which we've never been to before, so we'll be touring in Latin America.
He doesn't stop that one, does he?
No, you've got to keep going, haven't you?
You're going to sing us out now with your latest single.
Yes.
Right.
Tell us about it.
It's from the album, it's our new single, For Whom the Bell Tolls, it's called. Mm. And it's a ballad.
It's a ballad.
Yeah, yes. And what did you say earlier, Barry? You didn't say anything, did you, John?
It's a kind of a...
Just in case you did, so shut
it's
up.
It's a kind of a torch song, really, isn't it?
Well, you said that word earlier, torch song. A word to conjure. No, I said it, and you said, oh. And,
It's been great to meet you.
A word to conjure.
Would you like to sing it for us,
right.
For whom the bell
thank
tolls?
You,
the Bee Gees, thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you very much. Sorry.